years of academic experience, which includes 6 years of international experience in Philippines and Hanoi, 12 years of national experience as an ARS senior scientist in Indian Council of Agricultural Research, 2 years as a visiting professor at Indira Gandhi Institute of Developmental Research, Mumbai, and around 13 years in the State Agricultural University as a professor and director of Agribusiness Management School, Dean, Principal, and University Head of Agri-Economics Department, Professor Jayashankar, Telangana State Agricultural University, Hyderabad. To his credit, sir has about 17 research projects that were carried out in the field of agricultural economics related to impact assessment of technology, irrigation, and policies. Sir has organized 12 capacity building workshops for researchers and policymakers. Sir has published 41 research papers in refereed national and international journals, about 100 articles in leading newspapers in Telugu and English, and nearly 100 papers presented in national, international conferences, seminars on various socio-economic and policy issues related to agriculture and farmers. Sir is honored with many awards like the best state level scientist in 2012 by the government of erstwhile Andhra Pradesh, the outstanding academic leadership award in the year 2012 from the government of Maryland state of United States of America, and the best scientist award by the International Rice Research Institute in the year 2002 for outstanding contribution in the field of research. Sir, it's our honor to hear you today. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you very much. I'm sure you are all visible, my slides.
Yes, sir. Your okay. Slides are visible, sir.
So my topic today is very simple and linking with ongoing debate on the three new agriculture bills brought out by the government of India about a month back, how they are going to have an impact on rural markets, particularly with respect to agriculture, both producers markets and consumer markets. And that is my brief topic, and I have a few slides. I'm not going to talk much about real agribusiness based principles here, which were very common, and I'm sure you might be from the faculty of agribusiness or a business management, but I'll try to enlighten you with on basically ongoing contemporary issue of agriculture policies in the light of new agriculture bills and how they are going to affect the rural markets in India. So the first, I would like to very briefly explain how rural markets and agriculture have a very close and interlinked relationship, and followed by I want to give a brief account of revisiting the India's agriculture policies since 1950s in just 2-3 slides. To know the current agricultural bills, we should also know what was the situation before. So how agriculture was pursued in the first 5-year plan to till today. Then what are those three new agriculture bills or new farm bills brought out by the government of India? Then what are their implications on these rural markets? So let us just talk about three things, actually, three important challenges in any economy. And when economy is transforming, I think this is a very general slide. I would always like to share with particularly in a young faculty and the students. We should understand certain key changes in economy as we progress. So many people think that this change is something bad, something is good, but these are all inevitable changes across the world. You can go to even, you see 1950s, how US economy was and how today. For last 150 years, transformation of US economy also passed through these changes. Even India is also passing through same changes, which are inevitable. First and foremost change, what we see is industrialization. I think as we moved from first 5-year plan to till today, the industrialization was the biggest contributor to the overall Indian economy, and that is inevitable, industrialization, and followed by urbanization. And today almost more than 40% of the India's people are living in urban, and which is going to be another 20% by year 2030. So urbanization is also an inevitable process through which economy develops in any country. And mechanization, again, when we move from primitive economy to progressive economy, then obviously we always invent and use labor saving machines in all sectors, not necessarily in agriculture, even household sector. You go and see in many households in most of the metros, you find washing machine, you find even dryer, you find the even vacuum cleaner, you find what you call mixie, and all kinds of household mechanization, which is because the time, the opportunity cost of time will go up as we move towards a high economy scenario. So this is a very, very common phenomena which we experience as we move forward. Then of course feminization, which is a very, very important factor. Feminization means involvement of more women in economic activities. Today, if you see, for last 15 years to 20 years, the women participation has been increased. So in economy, for example, most of the Southeast Asian countries like in Thailand, Philippines, Vietnam, 60% of the most of the economic activities are done by women. But say in the same countries 50 years back, even not 30%. So today Indian economy is also getting maximum benefits from women participation. This is a feminization, and which is also a very common phenomena in the economy. So these are the four broad changes we see, and these are all we are also experiencing in the economy. So let us talk about our own core topic, how rural markets are linked with agriculture. Let's talk about the Indian economy is basically rural based even till today. The strength of the Indian economy still lies in rural areas, because still more than half of the, about 60% of the people still live in rural areas, largely deriving their basic economic activity from agriculture and allied sectors. Therefore, the trickle down effect, what we call the trickle down effect, means the agriculture development will have an impact on non-agriculture through demand supply of both agriculture and non-agricultural sectors. As a result, overall economy will go. So this is a starting point for any economic development is a primary activity, primary economic activity. The primary economic activity for the 60% of the Indians is still in agriculture. So agriculture and rural market. Agriculture is basically rural based. So rural economy is based on agriculture. So these are interlinked. So therefore, agriculture has a key role in overall rural markets and rural economy. And still, they are playing a very, very crucial role through trickle-down approach. And the trickle-down mechanism is still play an important role both in changing the structure and functions and operational mechanism of both producers' markets as well as consumers' market. So in this context, we should understand how agriculture has been growing, how agriculture policies were pursued in the before and after independence, and even after, particularly for last couple of years in the present regime. So let us talk about So now, as I told you, let us revisit different agricultural policies adopted by the government of India, particularly after 1950, that means after the commencement of the first five-year plan. But what was the situation when we got independence? I think most of you might be knowing, but it is good to again remind ourselves what were the situations when India got freedom in 1947. And the most important serious problem India had at the time of independence was acute food shortage. Nearly more than half of the India's food requirements used to come through imports, particularly from US, Europe, and Australia, under a law that's called Public Law 480. I think it's a very popular law. And India used to get a lot of food, particularly maize and wheat, from US, Europe, and Australia. That was the situation when India got freedom. Then food shortage and starvation deaths were very common soon after independence. Then the biggest challenge was how to overcome this food shortage related deaths or problems. That was the biggest challenge before the first prime minister and first government of the independent India. So, and the whole focus and the whole resources, whole effort were devoted to solve this problem, because for any human being, what we need is basically food, followed by shelter, of course, clothes and shelter. So food was the biggest problem for half of the Indian population at that time. Therefore, the focus was given to enhance the food production using all available resources, technologies from the first 4-5 year plans period. Okay, let us talk about what are the key factors and or key drivers of all agriculture policies in India. If you start see different agriculture policies adopted in India right from 1950s to till say 2000 or 2010, the whole policies moved around basically 4 key elements. Number 1 is a technology. Number 2, irrigation. Number 3, policy, particularly market and input-output related policies. Then 4th and most important is the developing infrastructure and institutions that are required for agriculture sector. And all those policies, which we are going to see in an abstract manner in the next few slides, they all moved around these 4 key elements. Let us see how agriculture policies were during the first 4-5 year plan period, that is 1950 to 70, soon after independence, the first government of free independent India thought that what is more important for food production is agriculture, and what is more important to enhance the agriculture production is irrigation. Therefore, the top priority was given to build a big, large scale, multi-purpose irrigation projects. Those are the 7 irrigation projects were taken up by the first independent India government in 1950s, which were also later called as the modern temples of India. One of them is very much in Telangana, that is called Nagarjun Sagar project, and likewise Bakra Nangal project, Hirakud project, and also Srishaila projects, and another 2 more. So there are seven such big irrigation projects were initiated and completed within 10 to 15 years from the initiation of those projects. So unlike these days, at that time there were no such a big construction technology. Most of those things were done through manual, but still they could able to complete on time, because at that time there was no hesitation, there were no court cases, everything was very, very focused and with a lot of commitment towards the country, unlike today. So therefore, the large irrigation projects like Nagarjun Sagar project that was initiated in early 50s could able to complete by 1966, and the first water was released in 1965 or 64 itself, within 15 years. So then the biggest policy that was taken up by the government of India was Essential Commodity Act 1955. Under this act, the government has prohibited storage and of essential commodities that are required for a day-to-day life of a human being, like drugs, food, and basically drugs, foods, and other services which are required for a human life on day-to-day basis. And there was a restriction that no trader should store more than this much limit for more than this many days, so that these essential commodities should be available in the market, so that people will not suffer for shortage of these commodities. Therefore, this act helped a lot, particularly in reaching out several essential commodities to the rural people, particularly poor, rural and urban poor people. And another important policy that was taken up by those period was the domestic manufacturing of the fertilizers and tractors, which are essential for agriculture development in the long run. So hardly you don't have any tractor manufacturing or fertilizer manufacturing when we got independence. And like Mahindra, I think first tractor company that started producing tractors for agriculture in early 1950s, and fertilizer factories. At that time, India used to import very little fertilizer. So fertilizer used in agriculture was very, very little, almost not even an average 3 to 4 kilos per acre or an average. But now today it is almost 200 kilos because there was no domestic production of the fertilizers during those days. And so therefore the policy was to produce tractors and fertilizers required for a agriculture purpose. Then the R&D and the seed policy, I think 1964, there was a first seed act and accordingly National Seeds Corporation was established to produce and supply the seeds of modern varieties to the farmers. And likewise, every state government has also set up state seed development corporations in each state. And agriculture research and development was given the top priority. And the first agriculture university was also established in 1960 at Pantnagar. It's about a big and first land grant university. And likewise, the Indian Council of Agriculture Research was reorganized and modernized and set up several new agriculture research institutions to meet the country's agricultural requirements. And that was also in a big way in 1960s and 64. Then you have the irrigation, you have the technology through research, and you have the inputs like fertilizers and tractors required for agriculture. And then since the farmers are very poor economically, so to encourage these farmers to purchase these inputs, and government also started supplying on subsidized rates. So subsidy was the biggest boost during the 50s and 60s to use more modern inputs for agriculture. Then the once you produce more and more, then in simple economics, when your supply increases, your prices come down. So therefore, to protect the farmers from price glut in the event of the more production, the government of India has come up with a minimum support price policy in 1964 and imposed that, and the prices of any agricultural commodity should not fall below certain level. That is called minimum support price. It is guaranteed by the farmer. So if prices falls below MSP, then the government agencies like Food Corporation of India, Cotton Corporation of India, NAFED, and those central organizations, like and as well as state organizations, will come forward, enter in the market, and procure those commodities at MSP levels from the farmers. So that is the biggest boost to the farmers to produce more and more. And there is no price risk. The price was guaranteed by the government through price policy in 1964. So then the whatever technology that was produced through agriculture research systems in 1960s has to be reached out to the farmer through a different extension methods and extension programs like T&V system, travel and visit, training and visit system, a very popular T&V system in agriculture extension. Likewise, intensive agriculture development program, intensive agriculture area program. So likewise, several extension, frontline extension programs were initiated by the government of India, implemented in different parts of the country to promote the technology diffusion as well as input use levels. That helped a lot. That was the biggest policy initiated in the 60s. Then another important, the institutions were built during those period. Whatever institution today you see, Food Corporation of India, NABARD, and nationalization of the banks, that's the biggest decision that was taken by the government during 1969, nationalizing the 14 commercial banks. And given a mandate that every commercial bank should lend to the extent of 40% to the rural areas, a rural sector, including 18% to agriculture sector. That was the minimum level fixed for commercial banks after nationalization of these 14 nationalization banks. That helped a lot to provide the credit to the farmers as well as other rural artisans to promote their rural economy. So, and today, whatever institutions you have, like Food Corporation of India, Central Warehousing Corporation, and NAFED, Cotton Corporations, Jute Corporation, all those institutions were established after between 60 and 70, particularly to protect the farmer as well as the consumer. So among them, of course, as I told you, nationalization of bank is very, very important step that was taken by the government of India during 1969. Then look at the policies between 70 and 90, another 20 years after. Rural credit was further strengthened. not only for agriculture but for other rural economic activities. So rural credit, like regional rural banks, were established in 1975, and in addition to nationalization of the banks, and further another six commercial banks were nationalized in 1980. So with that, 20 banks were nationalized by 1980. Then there was an apex bank that was exclusively set up for agriculture and rural development, that is called NABARD, National Bank for Agriculture and Rural Development, that was set up in 1982. That means rural credit was given the top priority between 70 and 80. In addition to promoting the agriculture development, thereby farmers income, non farm employment programs were also initiated, several IRDP. If you look at the rural development programs initiated, Garib Hatao, poverty elevation programs, most of those programs were initiated between 70 and 80, particularly IRDP, NREP, National Rural Employment Scheme, later Jowar Rozgar Yojana, JRY. So likewise, several non-farm rural employment programs were initiated to improve the rural income, not only by agriculture but also non-farm employment sources. Then the reorganization of the agricultural R&D, I think in 1980s particularly, the whole IC, Indian Council of Agriculture Research and Agriculture University systems were reorganized and established more and more institutions to participate in research and development for agriculture purpose. Then of course, seed policy of 1983 is a very famous, accordingly even the seed was also added to the Essential Commodity Act, one of the essential commodity. No seed company should store seed of any crop for more than a certain quantity for more than certain period, because seed should be available to the farmer during the season. So therefore, this kind of regulation helped these farmers to access quality seed on time. Then the another important, whatever policies that were now I'm explaining, most of those things were targeted for cereal development. Cereals means rice, wheat, maize, pulses. But later we realized that as consumption pattern has been changing, as your income levels are increases, so therefore there is a huge demand coming for edible oil. So edible oil shortage was the biggest problem, and we solved the problem of paddy, wheat, maize and other food productions, but edible oil shortage was the biggest issue, and India used to import more than half of the edible oil requirement. Therefore there was special emphasis on the edible oil promotion. Edible oil policy of 1980 helped a lot to double the edible oil production within a 5 years of the period. Then the fruits and vegetables was given a top priority. Horticulture development was a top priority after 1980. It helped a lot, particularly in enhancing the production of the fruits and vegetables. So then what are the achievements of all those things which were talked about, the pro-farmer agriculture policies until 90s? Green Revolution, that is basically, as I told you, efforts of the 60s and 70s, particular cereals. Cereals means rice, wheat, maize and millets. And White Revolution, particular dairy development of 1980s, helped a lot to produce milk significantly. And today India is the largest milk producer in the world. Then Blue Revolution, which is particularly happened in the fisheries, particularly after 90s. Then we also achieved a yellow revolution, that is in edible oils, because the edible oil production was doubled in a 5 years after initiation of the oil seeds technology mission. Then likewise, pink revolution, particularly in the horticulture. As I told you, today most of the growth in agriculture is coming from horticulture sector. Most sunrise sectors, what we call in the economy sunrise sector, the growth in horticulture sector was more than 10% until 2010-2015. So therefore, the pink revolution, the production of fruits, today India is the second largest producer of fruits and vegetables, next to China. So now what has happened to agriculture policies after 90s? I think this is a very interesting. After 90s, there was a shift in the overall economic policy direction, after globalization, after reforms, whatever you mean. But the first 15 years after economic liberalization started, there was a gradual withdrawal of the subsidies on agriculture. entry of the private sector, particularly in the seed sector and R&D sector, particularly domestic seed sectors. Then mechanization was started promoting on a large scale in all activities of agriculture. Then the livestock development and dairy and livestock was given top priority, and also aquaculture, that is the fisheries, was given the top priority. Then after 2005, realizing that there was a lot of farmer suicides were reported. I think most of you just recall the situation between 2003 and 5, a lot of food farmer suicides were reported, and agriculture growth was coming down, and there was a lot of crisis in agriculture. That led to revisit of the past agriculture policies after 19, then reoriented to correct some of those policy distortions in agriculture sector. As a result, the government of India after 2004 started promoting again agriculture through different ways and means. Particularly, the new APMC Act was amended. Agriculture Produce and Market Committee Act was amended in 2005. In all states, except one or two states of the state, agriculture is a state subject. Government of India taken initiative and asked all the states, and most of the states have amended their act and allowed the contract farming, but it did not really make a big progress, although it was allowed officially through new APMC Act. Then the gradual withdrawal of the subsidy was continued, while on other hand, due to as a part of the economic reforms, but at the same time, entry of the multinational companies in seeds and R&Ds were also promoted. But most important is the large scale mechanization was promoted after 2005, because there was a huge labor wages because of the increased labor wages in non-farm sector. It has got also effect on agriculture wages. Therefore, and to cope up with increasing agriculture wages, large scale mechanization was also given. That was another policy. Then the agriculture infrastructure was built a lot actually during that period, during the, that is called a RKVY, Rashtriya Krishi Yojana program, that was initiated by the Government of India in 2005, which is continued. It is still continuing, but with less focus. So all these policies a little bit helped, but the policy focus was shifted from agriculture after 90 particularly, but after 2005 was also focus was more on industry and service sector, but agriculture was at least to some extent received some importance even during this period. Then of course skill development was given a top priority. Agriculture R&D was strengthened. I think during this period several new agriculture research institutions were established. Of course, this is a period, I think you are all from the universities and education system. You might be aware of that in 2008, at the end of the 10th five-year plan, beginning of the 11th five-year plan, every state was given one IIT, each state was given one NIT, each state establishment of new higher learning institutions like ISERS, NISERS, and national law schools, and national schools of architecture. If you just see the major today's top centrally sponsored, centrally funded higher learning institutions were established between 2008 and 2011. I think that was a golden period for higher education. And likewise, it's also a golden period for agriculture education also during that period, because the five-year plan period was given top priority for education and technical education as well as the higher education. Then outcomes of all those efforts for last 60 years plus, and I think I want to give a few numbers without going into details. And if you see the million tons, what is the total food production in India? Food production is different from food grain production. Food production includes food grain, pulses, oilseeds, sugar, tea, coffee, meat, milk, and fruits, vegetables, everything what we eat. Food is a very broader term. Food grain means only rice, wheat, maize, and pulses. But beyond food grains, there are several other foods we eat every day, like fruits, vegetables, chicken, goat, meat, and milk, egg, fish, prawns, all those things comes under food production, and the total sum of all those food production has been increased from just merely 188 million tons in 1970-71 to now almost it is a 825 million tons by 17-18. Now it is almost touching 1,000 million. That's over 1 billion metric tons as on today. That is a third largest food producer in the world. First one is still it is a China, 1.4 billion metric tons, followed by US, 1.2 billion metric tons, and India is now almost 1 billion metric tons of food of various categories like vegetables. So these are the biggest achievement India made, and I don't think any other country, India is the youngest independent country, got independence only 1947. Along with India and after 1947, I'm sure if you see the political history, there are another 75 countries got freedom across the world, particularly in Africa, Latin America, and also in South and Southeast Asia, particularly. 75 countries, small and big, medium, all countries together, 75 countries got freedom after India got independence in 1947. Most of those countries are still struggling for food shortage, but India is the only country that achieved self-sufficiency and now biggest, third largest food producer, followed by Bangladesh. Bangladesh also could able to really make a big progress in food production. Now it is self-sufficient to Bangladesh also, which got freedom in 1971 only. So as a result, but our population is also increasing. Somebody can ask, in 1970, our population is not even 35 million, 350 million population. 350 are just around 40 crores, that is a 400 million. But today, almost 1.3 billion. Along with increase in food production, our population also increased. But the rate of increase in food production is higher than the rate of increase in population growth. As you can see those numbers from here, this is called per capita food production. That means kilos of food production per year per person. So number of kilos per person per year. So every year, on average, now we produce as an Indian, each Indian is producing nearly 600 plus kilograms of food of different kinds. It includes rice, wheat, maize, fruits, vegetables all together. That means on average, we produce every day, each individual average, we are producing about 2 kilos. But are we eating? Are we eating 2 kilos every day? Where this huge 2 kilos of everyday per capita production is going? I think this is a big question. That is almost half of it is either in the wastage at different levels. If you take those numbers, then of course the consumption side, that is different story. But this is a production side, and really we made a big progress. Now let us talk about what is happening to agriculture policies after 2015. I think this is a very fact, and it's always the national policies are driven by a political party that is in the power. So this is a typical future. We don't know what we will do. So the policy of Obama was different from policy of the previous man, Bush. So likewise, you know, in India also same. When Nehru was the prime minister, he had a different vision. When Indira Gandhi was the prime minister, she had a different vision. When Manmohan Singh was there, he had a different vision. When Vajpayee was there, his policy was different. So naturally, in democratic setup, the political party that is in the power will have its own policy according to their own mandate and their own ideology. So after 2015, obviously there is a change in the political regime in the government of India level. So obviously there is a change in the policies also, not only in agriculture, even all sectors like the education policy has been changed, economic policies have been changed, industrial policies have been changed, and agriculture policies also have been changed according to the priorities of these new governments. So the gradual withdrawal of the subsidies were continued, but at the same time, the minimum support price, which is a key policy instrument in boosting the overall agriculture production, what you observe after 2015, the rate at which MSP increases every year is coming down. For example, last 7 years, the rate of increasing in minimum support price of paddy was just around 3%. If you take the previous 7 years, it's about 6 to 7%, 8%. So in all crops, same thing. It's not just necessary a paddy or wheat. Most of the minimum support prices of many crops were increasing, but at decreasing rate as compared to previous years. Then withdrawal of the subsidy on different inputs, but the rate at which withdrawal is, it was started even 1990 itself. It's not that only present government is doing, but the rate at which the subsidies are withdrawing is at much higher during the last 5-6 years. Then the agriculture was viewed as agribusiness, which is required for really adding the value addition. And this was a top priority of the present government. I think that is one most welcoming policy that is required to really add more and more value to the produce. And a special focus was also given promoting the corporates and multinational companies in agriculture. That is the big issue of the debate, whether it is really relevant for India, it is required for India, for the Indian farmer. Come to a conclusion that whether really corporates are good or bad, it may take some time to really analyze it. So in this context, the present government brought, according to their priorities, according to their policy, three new farm bills. Number one, the farmers produce trade and commerce, trade and commerce promotion, and also what you call facilitation bill. That means here, this term is very big, very fashionable, and what you call the corporate terminology, the name of this bill. But in a simple way, the bill tells is that government has withdrawn its restrictive role from the market. Farmer can sell his produce anywhere, anytime, to anyone in the country. Interstate movement was totally removed. Earlier, there were interstate movement of the agriculture produce was restricted, particular food produce. That is basically keeping in view the Essential Commodity Act, keeping the need for locally availability of the food grain production. You can't take out food from one place to other place if the prices are high in other place, because otherwise food may be shortage in the place where it is produced. So, and that kind of restrictions were removed. Now farmers are allowed to take his produce anywhere in the country, anywhere in the world, anytime, anywhere to anyone. Whatever price the buyer offers, he can sell it. It looks like very good. Listening is very, very fancy. But what is happening in the reality? This bill, even after a lot of restrictions and after of regulations in the regulated markets, minimum imposition of the minimum support price, farmers were cheated and looted by the many, many mediators. Now, government has totally withdrawn from its regulatory role in the market. Just it allowed to market forces. Can India still, 85% farmers are small and marginal. Or will take about 30 bags or 30 bags of paddy anywhere in the country. He can't take it. He has to sell it to the local, particular local market or local regulated market. So by doing this, by removing all these restrictions, now all these public sector functionaries will become different, like regulatory markets and market inspectors and all those powers that were given earlier were withdrawn. Now only traders and millers, in case of paddy, and also middlemen, whatever they offer, when they can buy, they don't buy. Like you have seen an example in Miryalguda area, I think about 2 weeks back, farmers were waiting in front of the rice millers for selling their paddy 3 days, 4 days, day and night. And they are not willing to buy, and no regulated market, no restrictions. Now, earlier, the revenue departments and market inspectors, all those people used to have a lot of powers. that you must buy agriculture produce at a minimum support price. Now, no minimum support price. For example, paddy minimum support price is 1,885 per quintal of paddy. But today, most of the farmers, at least in many paddy producing belts in Telangana and also in Andhra Pradesh, are not getting more than 1,700 to 1,750 rupees per quintal. Even we got, just myself, I had a paddy and we sold out just 1,730 rupees just 5 days back in Miryalada area. That was the situation because you don't have any power. Earlier, there was a compulsory, regulation that you must buy at MSP, minimum support price. Now there is no guarantee because of this new act. The another act, new bill was the farmers' empowerment and also the promotion of the agreement price. Agreement price is nothing but any farmer can have a forward contract with any company, any corporate, at a certain price. Okay, you produce this much and I will offer, say, 2,000 rupees per quintal of paddy. But the question is, compulsory at that price base, at that price, agreed price. The simple is that there was no legality. If you see the agreement copy, that was 18-page agreement copy prepared under this act, has mostly favorable clauses and provisions for the corporate. And corporate can withdraw from the agreement and farmers cannot sell to others. He has to sell to only that corporate with whom he had an agreement, but at even lower price on account of the poor quality. So there are a lot of quality parameters were mentioned for agricultural commodities in that agreement. So obviously farmers were looted. Even now, if you see the cotton and the paddy, in the name of moisture content, so farmers were offered very, very low price. Instead of, say, in cotton, even 3,000 rupees, 3,500 rupees sometimes because of high moisture content. So all those things were there. Then in this context, and according to second new farm bill, obviously big corporates will enter and take over, and naturally the small traders and the local traders and retailers will have a big problem. They will lose their small business when the corporates entered, had an agreement is breached or agreement is honored. Again, it is depending upon the whims and fans of a corporate as per the agreements. Then third farm bill was Essential Commodity Act amendment. Because the Essential Commodity Act of 1955 prohibits interstate movement, prohibits storage. And by bringing an amendment to that Essential Commodity Act of 1955 under this new farm bill, and all restrictions were removed. Food grains were removed from essential commodities. Anybody can store any quantity of food grains for any number of period, and you can sell it anywhere in the country or in the world. So what would happen? So you buy food grains at lower price from Telangana, for example, and sell it in a place where you get higher price by the middleman, not farmer. Farmer remains is at a disadvantage position, but only corporates will be at advantageous position according to those three bills actually. So now, let us look at the recent information. I thought you must know the where farmers are selling. What are those agencies for three major crops? This is reported by National Sample Survey Organization in its report. There are three agencies. First is APMC Act earlier. Of course, now also it is there. Agriculture Produce Market Committees Act, which were now will become defunct after these new bills are entered. Almost 29% of the total paddy produced in India was marketed through APMC Act, which are regulated markets under the control of the market functionaries. And about 39% of maize was marketed through APMC Act, and wheat, which is a major commodity, particularly North India, Punjab and Haryana, where 100% is through regulated markets. But therefore, at national level, it is coming to be around 44% of the total wheat output is sold in Agricultural Produce Market Committees Act. Therefore, Punjab farmers are wise. They are strongly against these new bills that now private traders will come and buy at lower price than the MSP. Now today they are getting MSP because they are selling in Agriculture Produce Market Committee Act, and now APMC will act. APMCs may not buy at MSP because there was no obligation under this new act. Therefore, they are the one who are the first losers. Therefore, they are the one who are really strongly hesitating against these new farm bills. And the other agency that buy agriculture produce from the market was the local traders are the major really source of buying the major leading buyers of the agriculture produce in the villages. Say for example, in case of maize or almost more than 40% in case of maize and paddy, but in wheat nearly 29% only. Then other sources like rice millers, the local exchange for purpose, all those things, 15% in case of maize and about 30% in case of paddy, and also 27% of the. So that means this structure will change now. Now this structure will change in the years to come in the new farm bill regime, because APMC Act will become defunct after a few years, and local traders will also be disappearing, and you get a new big entry in this structure that is called corporates. Both national and multinational corporates will come. So what are the implications? I have one more slide other than this. Producers market, as I told you, there's a big threat to these small rural markets, and those rural markets will be replaced with big corporates, and both national and multinational, and a threat to small traders. Actually, today we have in India there were 20 million small traders in rural areas whose livelihood is based on this local trading, both agriculture commodities and non-agricultural commodities, and their livelihood, their employment is really questionable once the big corporates entered and take over the whole agriculture marketing in the rural areas. Then the price volatility is a big problem. Obviously, the producers' share in consumer price will come down further because of the increasing middlemen and because of the withdrawal of the regulations. Then the another important is the spirit of MSP. The whole key object of MSP is diluted now. MSP is no longer has relevance. Only the market price, whatever the offer by whatever the price that is offered by the corporates have only relevance. Now, no government functionaries will come forward to buy the agriculture produce at MSP in the years to come. So these are all the some of these implications on producers' market. Of course, as I told you, the losing of the what you call bargaining power for farmers. Now, earlier farmers have a bargaining power when they have members in the rural APMC Act, and there is a system in which the market has to function. But now there is no system, so it's all in the hands of the corporates. Whatever it is, the mercy of the corporates. So that is only a system. And likewise, there is also change is likely to happen in the consumer markets. As I told you, the small traders, retailers, another side is even retailers. Will also be affected their employment, and also by losing some of the rural employment when corporate enters in the major agriculture field. Then what is alternative for rural depending on some of the implications likely to be arising out of these new farm bills, and also there is a more financial pressure on the consumers. Obviously, consumers price will also go up. So these are all the some of these implications that will happen in the I think I will stop it here because this is a big topic. I tried my best to cut short and just put it in a simple way so that everybody will understand, because I don't know the profile of the audience actually, but I know that they are all faculty working in different universities. I thought this is a good information. And most welcome for any comments or any. So it's a big debate. I don't want to enter any argument, but a good clarification, good debate, most welcome.
Sir, good afternoon, sir. I am Gangarazu, sir. Sir, hello.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, I have a doubt about the new farm bill, sir. That is regarding the MSP, sir. Is it as of now? Is it immediately implemented, sir? The new farm bill.
Actually, you know the system, how an act, how a law will be made in the democratic system. First, three stages. Actually, it is two stages. But in this agricultural bills, the government first brought ordinances. Yes, ordinance, even the parliament was not in a session. And any emergency that is required for the country, this government can bring an ordinance. And first they brought the ordinance sometime in, I think, June or May or June this year.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Okay, are you visible now?
Yes, I'm visible, sir.
I heard.
Okay, but I can't see you. I can't see any one of you.
Sir, I'm listening to the class via desktop, sir, but my desktop doesn't have webcam, sir.
Okay, no problem. So
can see you, sir.
Yeah. So first, government of India brought three ordinances in May this year.
Okay, sir.
During the period of lockdown, when the entire country was focusing on to save their lives from corona, and we are all in the lockdown, confining ourselves to the homes. During that time, government of India brought silently three new farm bills, ordinances.
Okay.
President of India issued the ordinance. Normally, ordinance come the area emergency, but that these are the emergencies.
Okay.
Then once you brought the ordinances, within 6 months, these ordinances have to be passed by the both houses of the parliament. That was done in August and September, August particularly, during the last parliament session.
Okay, sir.
Then after, that is second step, after passing those two houses of all these, whatever bill, the act, what you call act, once this passes, it goes to the president for a final gazette notification, and that was also signed by the president of India. Now it has become a law.
Okay, sir.
With immediate effect.
Okay, sir.
So now already now we are in the new farm bills.
Okay, sir. From this very policy itself, the new farm bill is introduced, sir. Is already in existence, sir, from this
bill. Yeah, already now we are in the new farm bill regime.
Okay, sir. And there is no need to buy at the MSP. That is, there is no monitoring or regulation by the local bodies or government authorities in regarding the purchase of the farm produce at MSP. Is it right, sir?
Yes. Now there was no obligation on any party, but state governments have their liberty. If state governments want to protect the farmers, they can, their agencies can still procure MSP level. No ban on the state governments, because state governments have the equal responsibility and equal powers on agriculture, because agriculture is still in the state subject and under the Constitution of India as per the Article 246. Still, it is a state subject.
Sir, one.
Then,
sir, one question, please.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, there is any digital format to control the mechanism in this area, or to help the industry or farmers in this digital format? In this, there is a collaboration.
No, I didn't get your point.
Is there, government is having any type of a digital format?
See, now government of India has completely withdrawn from its role in agriculture market, either in any format, either digital or physical or any format. Nothing. So any farmer can buy, any farmer can sell anywhere in the country or in the world at any price to whom you want. There is no bar. There is no regulation. So even likewise, there is no regulation on the buyer also. Any trader can buy any quantity at whatever price from anywhere in the country. If I want, I can go and buy apples in Kashmir at lower price and sell it in Telangana at much higher price.
Sir, one more question. Suppose if I am a producer of wheat and I want to sell it to, say, for America, so I have to give the tax on this trade as a farmer.
Yeah, you can export now. Now you can export any agricultural commodity anyway. But of course, you have to pass through all these procedures, licensing and quality control and Fair Act and all those things are there. That is comes under the Ministry of Commerce. And there is an export to promotion division within the Ministry of Commerce, and you have to follow all the procedures. Earlier, if you want to export agriculture commodity, there is a special permission is required. Now there is no special permission. You can export.
Hello. Can you explain in Essential Commodities Act, sir, about EC?
Sir, you are on mute.
Sir, you are on mute, sir. Sir, you are not audible.
Sir, you are not audible.
Excuse me, sir, you are not audible, sir.
Madam, if possible, you can contact me, madam.
Yes, please wait. Hello.
Hello.
Are you hearing?
Once again, explain about the ECA, sir. Essential Commodities Act, new Essential Commodities Act.
Yeah, first let me explain you the original. Originally, the Essential Commodity Act was passed in 1955.
Okay, sir.
In which more than few hundred commodities and services were included in the Essential Commodity Act. Yes, and regulating and prohibiting storage of these Essential Commodity Acts, okay, for certain limit and for certain limit of the period. The primary objective was to allow these essential commodities and services available in the society, because somebody should not store it for long period, hoard it. It should not lead to hoarding, so that you will get higher price. So there is a possibility of hoarding Essential Commodity Acts, create an artificial shortage, then release when there is a shortage to get higher price. To avoid this kind of price manipulation, in 1955 itself, the government has brought out this Essential Commodity Act that helped a lot, actually, for so many poor people. But now, what this present government did, in order to bring the first and second farm bills into operation, this Essential Commodity Act is coming in the way. Therefore, to clear the way for implementing the first new farm bills, this Essential Commodity Act was amended by removing all food grains from the Essential Commodity Act. So now food grains are no longer Essential Commodity Act, Essential Commodities as per the Government of India, present Government of India. So therefore, anybody can store any quantity anywhere for any period of longer time. So that is a amendment that was brought by the present government in the 2 months back. Okay.
Sir, I would like to understand that this new farm bill, because after this bill, now the it is open to the market and how the market behaves on the particular agriculture product. So would like to understand which are the products or which are the agriculture produce you think will get affected negatively, and see some, because there may be some gains, some losses. So can you classify such products which will get negatively affected and maybe which may gain positively? Something on that, some thought on that.
Most of the agricultural commodities are perishable in nature, except little bit cereals and pulses, but otherwise most of them are perishable. The effect of these new farm bills on perishable commodities like fruits and vegetables may be less, because you can't store for a long period. Of course, now new cold storage structures may come, and even perishable commodities may be stored for longer period, and they can be released at a higher price in the event of the off season. But the effect is less. But in case of the non-perishable commodities like paddy, wheat, maize, pulses, and this effect is much higher, because the corporates procure at lower price. Particularly now, what is happening in the PID market is same thing, and cotton same thing. Farmers cannot store bulk of this produce, space for them actually, right from the farm to market. Generally, even from threshing yard to it goes to market yard earlier. Now market yard is closed, and there is no space for farmers to store at their houses. So whatever price these corporates and traders are offering, they have compelled to sell it. Now that is exactly happening in case of paddy. So therefore, most of the agricultural commodities will be sold out at lower price in this new market regime.
My second subsequent question to you, sir. So now this government and maybe previous government, they have promoted farmer producers organization in a very great or very large manner. So how do you see this farmer producer organization becoming a cushion to protect farmer interest and maybe in line with whatever the farm bill has been brought out by this government?
So the FPOs were promoted by the even previous government, also present government, with the help of. The FPOs are nothing but a group of farmers coming together and forming a company under Company Act and procuring and processing and selling it out. But now the FPOs may not be even continued. FPOs may be also disappeared in years to come, because now corporates will come. Why FPOs? The big corporates will enter now. Already they are entering. So I don't think even FPOs will also sustain in years to come. FPOs nothing but little modern cooperatives, but run on a commercial company principles instead of a cooperative principle. That is the difference between cooperatives and FPOs.
So you think that will be worsened by this act?
Yeah, FPOs may not be sustained in years to come.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sir, I have a question. Sir, I would like to ask you, the current bill that has been passed by the government, it is a natural extension of liberalization and privatization policy that started way back in 1999. So in this connection, the intention of the government is to modernize the economy, dismantling the agricultural in the rural area, and so that they can join in the urban organized sector. But during last several decades, it has been noticed the loss of livelihood by this process is not compensated by the creating new jobs. So how it explains that the prudence of the government, irrespective of the political ideology, BJP or Congress, they are following the same process, same tactics. Sir, what is your take on this?
No, you see here, I think I don't want to go into political economy of these policies, but the crux of the problem is whether previously when Vajpayee was there, when Manmohan Singh was there, and their respective NDA 1 and UPA 1 and 2 were there. But still, these governments maintained certain protective regulations to protect the farmers' interest. Still, because agriculture is still big source for rural employment and livelihood. 85% of the small and marginal farmers, because unfortunately, we did not create adequate non-farm employment opportunities in rural areas. We need to withdraw a large number of people from agriculture, that is no doubt. But withdrawing large number of people from agriculture doesn't mean that you dismantle the agriculture sector. What is important, that is exactly happened in China, create a non-farm rural employment opportunities through rural industrialization process. It's exactly what Mahatma Gandhi mentioned. This, the whole Gandhian principle of Indian economy is move around the rural industrialization. Most unfortunately, irrespective of the political parties, since 50s till today, there was a very less focus on the rural industrialization. We talk about Mahatma Gandhi so high, everybody claims. But when his basic economic principle of Gandhian principle of rural economy was totally forgotten by many political parties, forget about Congress or this party or that party or anybody. And instead of that, at least they are maintaining certain imbalance. Neither they are following the Gandhian principle or not a capitalistic principle, some kind of mixed economy, mixed principle, we can say. But now presently, the government is totally withdrawing its responsibility from agriculture, which is not correct, which is not good for the nation in the long run. Indian agriculture or Indian farmer has not reached that stage where he doesn't need any government support. He needs government support, he needs government regulation in order to protect his own farm produce in his own market. I think that is a difference. So therefore, still eighty-five percent of the rural people still depending on agriculture. But they don't have, even education is improved, skill is improved, but no opportunities for them to work in non-farm sector in and around the villages. We talked, but we never really focused. This exactly did in China, 20 years from 78 to 1998. They did it. Of course, their political economy is different. It is a centralized and controlled political economy. So they could succeed and withdraw a large number of people from agriculture and diverted into rural industries, improved overall rural economy and improved the agricultural productivity. And they produced everything for the whole world. Whatever you see in the entire world, you can see the Chinese product. It is all coming from rural industrial process. And we have not done that one. So that is the real problem.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, good afternoon. Is it audible? Hello.
Yeah.
Sir, good afternoon. Is it audible to you?
Yes.
Sir, I am S. Ramesh Babu from Gudlowler Engineering College, Andhra Pradesh.
Yeah.
My question is either the earlier agriculture bills or the latest bill. Is there any scope or confidence to promote the agriculture-based enterprise? The policy provisions will promote rural-based agri-processing units or any enterprise related to the agriculture.
Okay, see, any industry, either rural or urban, particularly rural, what we need for any entrepreneurs to set up an industry, agri-based industry, let us take agri-based industry in rural area. First and most foremost is rural infrastructure, good roads, availability of raw material and power, particularly, and of course availability of the labor and capital. Really, the government policies today, on the one hand, agri-business is a top priority. But when it comes to real picture, still rural roads are a big issue. And of course, power. Thanks to 2008 liberal policy of the during those governments that brought several power private sector, power plants and private sector. Now today, country as a whole is a self-sufficiency in power sector. So there was no issue, at least now. Power was the problem until few years back in rural areas and also in other areas, but now that was no longer a problem. But still, rural infrastructure is a big issue. And skilled manpower is a big issue. And capital, again, who is taking capital? See, there are two kinds of entrepreneurs. One is they want to, for a short-term benefits, take loan and do something and go away. And the real committed entrepreneurs really come forward and they are behind it and get succeeded. So I think we are lacking in these areas. Otherwise, agri-based entrepreneurs have the best opportunity in India. If somebody really want to be an agri-based entrepreneur, opportunities are plenty. Now at least power is no longer a big issue. But the government licensing and support is still very complicated. It was not as simple as it is there actually telling outside world.
Thank you. The reason I come to this question is, one side we are observing liberalizing the agriculture sector also in the way that new policy, if I'm right. Second side, that the government is keen in setting up of the new units or maybe Startup India, so many provisions for capital and so on. So put together based on these developments, one side the industrial promotion or promotion of small enterprise, another side liberalizing the agriculture sector. So can we expect any of such positive? That is why I ask. Thank you.
Thank you.
See, this, I don't know, if you see the Indian economy in the 18th, 19th and 20th century, we produce excellent raw material, export to other countries, get it processed and manufactured a final product, and again bring them back to India. This exactly is going to happen again. We talk about make in India, but not make by India. There's a lot of difference. Make by India, make in India. Who is making in India? Again, the multinationals, corporates are coming and using our cheap labor, our resources, making in India, taking away wealth from the country to other countries. Make by India is the more relevant than the make in India. Make for India. Make for India, again, you are exporting raw material, preparing some manufacturing elsewhere in the world and bringing those finished goods back to India. That is a make for India, make in India. But we didn't really focus on make by India. I think that is what is missing. The words are very fashionable. And if you critically analyze the words, you will understand.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Your categorical explanation is very right when it comes to the reality, not on the paper.
See, we talk many things very attractive way, because if you are good in communication, if you are good in attracting the public, you can tell many things. People will listen because your track record. But if you analyze critically, we as intellectuals, we should go by facts, not by emotional feelings. We need, see, exactly the East India Company came in 16th, 17th century and did the same thing. And after 200 years struggle, we got freedom. After 70 years, again, we are moving in the same direction as our previous kingdoms did it, but in a different manner, in a sophisticated manner. That's all.
Yes, sir, you are right. Absolutely. Thank you.
Sir, Janai Garu, you have given a very good explanation about the terms make in India and make by India, sir. I really am very happy to listen to your class, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Sir, I have one question, sir. Hello? What talent do you expect if at least state doesn't accept policy? Whether to accept this policy or not, it is discretionary with the state government.
Somebody is asking, I am not hearing anything.
Am I audible now?
Now you are. Yes.
Since it is in the discretion of state government, say for example, if 5 or 6 states doesn't accept policy, so what sort of imbalance do you expect in the agricultural sector?
There is a lot of disturbance. I am not able to listen properly.
Sir, Janai garu, sir.
Ah, sir.
Sir, I have one more doubt, sir. Can I ask you in Telugu, sir?
Chappandi, sir. Meeru swachhamaina telugulo maatladochu, nenu kuda alage maatladtanu.
Okay, sir. Sir, ippudu meeru new farm bill teesukochcharu kada, adi MSP rate ki MSP rate konalsina avasaram ledani meeru central government cheptundi.
బట్ బిల్ చెప్పారు సార్, అంటే అది బిల్లులోనే ఉంది, అది మనం నేను చెప్పడం కాదు. అది ఎంఎస్పి అనే పదం ఎక్కడ లేదు చట్టంలో.
ఓకే సార్, ఓకే సార్. ఐఎమ్ ఆస్కింగ్ అబౌట్ దిస్ హ్యాస్ టు బి, అంటే ఆంధ్రప్రదేశ్ అంటే స్టేట్ గవర్నమెంట్ లో వచ్చేసరికి ఆ ఎంఎస్పి బిల్ కి ఖరీ చేసేలాగా చూస్తుంది అని చెప్పాను అంటున్నారు. మరి ఇప్పుడు రెండు కూడా డిఫరెన్స్ వచ్చేస్తుంది కదా సార్, స్టేట్ కి సెంట్రల్ కి వచ్చేసరికి.
అంటే ఇప్పుడు ఏంటంటే సార్, అగ్రికల్చర్ అనేది ఈ రోజు కూడా రాజ్యాంగ పరంగా రాష్ట్రాల బాధ్యత. కేంద్రం చట్టాలు తెచ్చినప్పటికీ కూడా ఆర్టికల్ 246 ఆఫ్ ఇండియన్ కాన్స్టిట్యూషన్ ప్రకారము వ్యవసాయ రంగము, రైతు సంక్షేమము రాష్ట్రాల బాధ్యత అని రాజ్యాంగబద్ధమైన అధికారమే రాజ్యాంగం ఇచ్చింది. సో నథింగ్ ఈజ్ మోర్ దాన్ అబోవ్ కాన్స్టిట్యూషన్. నథింగ్ ఈజ్ ఈవెన్ వాట్ ఎవర్ బిల్స్ పార్లమెంట్ తీసుకొచ్చే యాక్ట్ కూడా రాజ్యాంగ పరిధిలోనే ఉండాలి. ఒకవేళ రాజ్యాంగ పరిధిని దాటాలనుకుంటే ఫస్ట్ రాజ్యాంగాన్ని సవరించి రాజ్యాంగాన్ని రాజ్యాంగపరమైన అంశాలను తొలగించి రాజ్యాంగ పరిధిలోనే తీసుకురావాలి చట్టాలు. రాజ్యాంగాన్ని పరిధిని మించి ఏ చట్టం తీసుకురాలేదు పార్లమెంట్ కూడా. రాజ్యాంగమే మనకు ఈజ్ అ టాప్, మనకు ఎబో రాజ్యాంగానికి పార్లమెంట్ కూడా విత్ ఇన్ కాన్స్టిట్యూషన్ లోనే పనిచేస్తుంది. ఏదైనా మనకు ఇబ్బంది ఉన్నది పాత రాజ్యాంగంలో ఒక ఇది ఈ ఆర్టికల్లో మనకు సవరణ అవసరం అనుకున్నప్పుడు మళ్ళీ దాన్ని ఆర్టికల్ని అమెండ్ చేసుకొని అప్పుడు మన రాజ్యాంగం ప్రకారం చట్టాలు తీసుకోవచ్చు. ఇక్కడ ఇప్పటికి కూడా యాజ్ ఆన్ టుడే అగ్రికల్చర్ ఈజ్ అ స్టిల్ రెస్పాన్సిబిలిటీ ఆఫ్ ది స్టేట్స్ యాజ్ పర్ ది కాన్స్టిట్యూషన్.
ఓకే సార్.
కాబట్టి స్టేట్స్ కు ఆ బాధ్యత ఉన్నది, వాళ్ళు తప్పించుకుంటానికి వీల్లేదు.
ఓకే సార్.
స్టేట్స్ ఇవ్వాలనుకుంటే మినిమం సపోర్ట్ ప్రైస్ ఇవ్వచ్చు, ఎక్కువ ఇవ్వచ్చు, ఏదైనా చేయొచ్చు.
ఓకే సార్. ఓకే సార్. సార్ దెన్ ఇస్ ద ఇఫ్ ద స్టేట్ గవర్నమెంట్ ఇస్ ఇన్వాల్వ్డ్ ఇన్ మెయింటైనింగ్ ద ఎంఎస్పి, దెన్ వెదర్ ద సెంట్రల్ గవర్నమెంట్ పర్పస్, సెంట్రల్ గవర్నమెంట్ పాలసీ of removing this MSP is served or not, sir?
ఇప్పుడు ఏం చేస్తారంటే, ఇప్పుడు మన ఆత్మ నిర్భర్ ప్యాకేజీలో కూడా కేంద్రం ఏం చేస్తుంది, ఈ కొన్ని చట్టాలు మీరు ఇంప్లిమెంట్ చేయకపోతే మీకు కేంద్రం ఇచ్చే గ్రాంట్స్ ఆపేస్తూ ఉంటారు. ఇది ఒక ఆనవాయితీ అన్నట్టు, ఏ ప్రభుత్వం అంతే. సో ఇగో ఈ కేంద్రం ఇచ్చే చట్టాన్ని మీరు అప్లై చేస్తేనే మీకు వచ్చే గ్రాంట్స్ ఇస్తాము, మీకు అగ్రికల్చర్ కు సంబంధించిన బడ్జెట్ కొన్ని స్కీమ్స్ మీకు వర్తిస్తాయి, మీరు ఈ బిల్ ఇంప్లిమెంట్ చేయకపోతే మీకు రావు, అట్లా ఉంటుంది.
You said that India is in the second position in terms of horticulture, that is in terms of production, sir, or exporting, sir?
In terms of production.
In terms of production, sir. And fruits and vegetables and flowers are also comes under this horticulture, sir.
And all horticulture second largest producer after China.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Okay. Overall agriculture third after China and US.
Okay, okay. China, US. Overall agriculture. Sir, and another doubt, sir. We have about the yellow revolution. The before what you call yellow revolution is primer than the what you call pink revolution. But in pink revolution, we have achieved the topmost position. What about this yellow revolution, sir?
Yellow revolution లో మనము 1985-90 మధ్యలో మాత్రమే సాధించగలిగాం. బట్ మన పర్ క్యాపిటల్ కన్సంప్షన్ ఆఫ్ ఎడబుల్ ఆయిల్స్ హస్ ఇంక్రీస్డ్ ట్రెమెండస్లీ, బట్ ప్రొడక్షన్ ఈస్ స్టాగ్నెంట్ ఆఫ్టర్ వర్డ్స్. నౌ టుడే వి ఆర్ ఇంపోర్టింగ్ దాదాపుగా 75,000 crore వర్త్ ఎడబుల్ ఆయిల్ అండ్ పల్సెస్ టుగెదర్ వి ఆర్ ఇంపోర్టింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ డిఫరెంట్ కంట్రీస్. ఐ థింక్ స్టిల్ వి ఆర్ జస్ట్ హాఫ్ ఆఫ్ ది రిక్వైర్మెంట్స్ ఆర్ కమింగ్ ఫ్రమ్ అవుట్ సైడ్ కంట్రీ. ఎడబుల్ ఆయిల్ అండ్ పల్సెస్. I think that is a top priority. But now they say, yeah, now trade is international trade. You don't need to produce here. You can buy from anywhere in the world. So that is the policy of the government.
Yes, sir.
I'm tempted to ask one question, sir. Again, Govind Verma from IRMA. This government is also promoting ODOP, one district, one product policy. So one district, one product, yes. So what is your take on considering these newly introduced bills and all? So what is your take on, particularly in this agriculture or horticulture produce?
Yeah, this is good. Actually, while introducing these bills, the Union Minister for Agriculture, as well as our Honorable Prime Minister, different occasions, one nation, one market for agriculture. Then there was heavy criticism on that. One nation, one agriculture market will not be possible, because agriculture by nature, it is a location specific. It is influenced by, it varies from ecology to ecology, soil to soil, source of water. And that's the reason why agriculture was kept under state list in the constitution. It is a different kind of situation. Whatever kind of agriculture that is there in Punjab may not be there in Kerala. It's totally different. Himachal agriculture is different from the agriculture of the Tamil Nadu. So therefore, agriculture is location specific. Within state, again, there is a huge variation. Now in India, we have more than 150 agroecological zones, as divided by planning commission about 20 years back. Even still, it is relevant. So therefore, one district, one product has some relevance, at least. But one nation, one market, you know, it's a very good, fashionable, actually, terms. One nation, one market. One nation, one market for industrial goods, workable. Even for services, workable, but not for agriculture. But one district, yes, one product. This is a good concept. Definitely, district-specific product can be promoted through value addition. This will work out. But we need to have a support policy and support infrastructure for that. In the absence of those, this again slogan will be remains as a slogan only.
Thank you.
Sir, I may be permitted to ask you one question.
Yeah, please go ahead.
Sir, how do you distinguish between this Raitu Bazaar and the Farm Bill? Wherein the Raitu Bazaar, I believe, is a prototype of the Farm Bill. Which is very successful, because farmers are getting their product directly from the farm and selling at their price, so which is useful for them. Even the Farm Bill also on similar model works. So how do you distinguish this one?
Now, Raitu Bazaru concept was introduced in 2002 in United Andhra Pradesh, 2002, and as you rightly said, working so well. It's a really one of the wonderful experiment that was introduced in United Andhra Pradesh during those days by that government. And the Raitu Bazaar concept is different. Raitu Bazaar concept is straightforward. There is a government who will provide a physical infrastructure in a designated place. And there is a marketing functionary to monitor and supervise the different transactions. And farmers will bring their particularly perishable commodities, fruits, vegetables, particularly from nearby locations, and sell it to the consumers. There is hardly any middleman between producer and consumer. This is a good experiment, and where consumers got benefited, both producers got benefited. But in the new farm bill, they can sell any, that's what I told you, this, new farm bills have a less impact on perishable commodities like fruits and vegetables, maybe remain same. But this will have a bigger impact on the, when what they do, they will, corporates will directly buy from the farmers through forward contracts as per the second farm bill, and store it in a cold storage for a longer period. And they will prevent this flow of the produce from the farm to this Raitu Bazaar. As a result, there will be a shortage in the market, and consumers will be affected, and these corporates will release those commodities from the cold storages at a higher price during the off season. So the problem is now all these, because this was removed from the Essential Commodity Act. Once any commodity removed from essential commodity act, anybody can store any quantity for any period. And that is the biggest problem. Now, the particular poor consumers will be affected.
Thank you, sir. Is that the only issue? Can they escape with the GST in right now we are implementing GST. Can they escape that holding and that will be that's what
any packed goods are entitled to tax GST. Packed food. If it is a loose Raitu Bazaar, no GST. But if you buy the same vegetables in a packed manner in a super mall, and you have to pay GST. Simple. As far as food products are concerned, GST Act clearly made it. All packed foods by any company is comes under GST regime. But Raitu Bazaar, farmer to producer, no GST, nothing.
Okay, sir.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Ravi is there? The line?
Yes, sir.
So, can we close?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Thank you, sir. On behalf of all the participants, I thank you, sir, for enlightening us on the agricultural policies, milestones in agricultural system, like green, white, blue, yellow, and pink revolutions, and new farm bills in India, and clarifying the queries of our participants very patiently. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much.
Sir, one request I would make, if possible, kindly share your at least email ID to, or maybe the organizer could share, you know, the.
Have Dr. V.
Yes.
You can take from there.
Yeah. Kindly share, madam, because we can be in contact and we can get further inputs on our work.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Participants.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. So for the participants, we are winding up for day one. So the everyday feedback can be given in the chat box, and the final feedback form has been filled on the last day of the FDP. The attendance form is already shared in the chat box. So tomorrow, the next session starts at 10 a.m. So I request the participants to join the session meeting by 9:45. Thank you. I thank all the participants.
I'm one question.